Hello students, in our previous lecture we have completed with work energy principle. Today we are going to start with a new topic, which is potential energy. Now if you remember, we have already discussed about kinetic energy. Today we are going to discuss about potential energy, right? And there are different types of potential energy. But to be specific, we are going to discuss two types of potential energies in this chapter. First one is gravitational potential energy, and the second one is spring potential energy. And among those two, gravitational potential energy is the most important one. Most important one because we will be discussing it more and we will be seeing the numericals on gravitational potential energy more in this chapter, right? Now, what is potential energy? Let's say there is a body. This is the earth, right? And this is the, let's say, body of mass m, right? And this is point P, and on the surface of earth this is point Q. And the distance between point P and Q, it is H. Now, if you remember, I have told you out, first of all, we are talking about the gravitational potential energy. But before that, let's see what is potential energy. Potential energy is the energy of a body which is possessed by it. Potential energy is the energy of a body possessed by a body due to its position, right? So its position determines its potential energy. Now we come to the gravitational potential energy. If you remember, in our chapter gravitation, we have talked about g, small g. What was small g? Small g was acceleration due to gravity, right? Small g is acceleration due to gravity. Now what is G? G is acting on each and every body. Like I am standing here, then there is our earth is pulling me towards itself with an acceleration G, right? With a force of gravity with G, right? Now that means there is a field around the earth which attracts each and everything towards itself with an acceleration G. So that means if this body is at this point P with mass m, and on the earth surface there is a point Q, and the distance between P and Q is h, then the earth will attract this body towards itself with a g force, right? Now let's say this is a piece of chalk, right? And there is a slab here, then I will put it on that slab. Then what will be the energy possessed by this chalk? It is here, it is possessing some energy. If I take it here, then it will have some different kind of potential energy, because position is changed, right? There is a difference between this position and this position. That's why the potential energy, the energy will change. So gravitational potential energy is nothing but the energy possessed due to its height, right? Why it will have some energy? Because if I just simply release the chalk, then it will fall on the surface of earth. That means earth is attracting, pulling this piece of chalk towards itself with a force mg, right? What was the force? In this case, mg, force formula is mass into acceleration, but here acceleration is g, which is acceleration due to gravity, right? Now if I am taking this chalk to this position, that means that I am giving it that much of energy to keep it from falling. So we say that the potential energy, gravitational potential energy, will be equal to the mass, right, into acceleration force, right? What is the formula for the work? Work is nothing but force into displacement. So in place of force we write mg and s. What is s? Displacement, it is h. So mgh, right? So gravitational potential energy is equal to gph, and it is represented by u. U is equal to mgh, right? And what will be its SI unit? SI unit for all forms of energy is nothing but joule, right? So SI unit for gravitational potential energy is joule, or any kind of energy, the SI unit is joule, right? And what is the formula for the gravitational potential energy? It is mgh, where m is mass, g is acceleration due to gravity, and h is height. So, and what is the value of g? It is 9.8 meter per second square, but sometimes we can also take it as 10 also, right? So this was gravitational potential energy. Now we come to the second topic of this chapter, second type of potential energy which we will be studying in this chapter, which is spring potential energy. Now what is spring potential energy? I hope this is clear to you. I'm rubbing this part. So let's say this is a spring. We all have seen a spring, right? This is the natural form of this spring. If it is kept on a table, then this is the natural form of a spring. I hope you have all seen a spring. What does a spring look like? Now let's say I stretch this spring. Right? Now I have applied a force here, right? And I am stretching this string. And the string stretches, let's say, by x. Right? String stretches by x length. Now, what will a spring try to do? We all know what is spring. We press the spring, it comes back to its, or it will try to come back to its natural position. So, there will be a force of restoration. Let's say it is Fr. Force of restoration, which will be applied by the spring to come back its original position. Right? This is the case when we have stretched the spring. Now we take the other case where we compress the string. Let's say I have compressed the string and this is x now. The distance between natural stage and the compressed stage, right? Now in this situation also we have applied a force in this situation, but the spring will try to come back to its natural position, so it will again apply a force of restoration. But in this case, the stretched one case, it was into this side, but in this case, in case of compression, it will be in this side, force of restoration. So to come back to its position. So what will be the formula for the spring potential energy? It is, the formula for the spring potential energy is half kx square. Spring SPE is equal to half kx square. Right? Now what is k? K is nothing but spring constant. Spring constant. Right? And what is the x? X is the distance between the original position or the compressed or the new position, whatever you want to say. Right? So half k into x square. This is the formula for the spring potential energy. Now we won't be using this formula much, because the main potential energy which we will be focusing in this chapter is gravitational potential energy. Right? So this was second type of potential energy, which is spring potential energy. I hope this is clear to you. Now we will be starting with a new topic. I hope this is clear. Now we will be starting with new topic, which is gravitational force is a conservative force. What is? gravitational force is a conservative force. This question can be asked to you directly in this form also. Gravitational force is a conservative force, explain. Right? So how do we do that? Do this. It is also related to the potential energy only. Now in this case, we have to take two situations. Let's say this is Earth. This is point Q. And this is point P. Right? An object is on this point on the surface of Earth of mass m. I took this object and raised its position and took it to point P. Let's say that this is the path. I simply took it and vertically I took it to the point P. Let's say the distance traveled is h. Right? Now in the second case, again Earth, this is point Q, this is point P, again the object is of mass m. But in this case, I took a different path. Let's say I went in the north position, from there I went to west, then again north, then to east, and then north, and then I reached point P. Now, what is the difference between the energies of both the points? It will remain, the gravitational energy will remain the same, which will be gravitational potential energy will be the same, which will be U is equal to mgh. Why so? Because gravitational force is a conservative force. Why? Because it only depends on initial and final position and does not depend on the path follow. Right? So whenever a question is asked from you that gravitational force is a conservating force, explain, then we will say that it is because it only depends on the initial and the final point, but it does not depend on the path followed. Right? So it just depends on the position of the, which is initial when the there is no force, and when the force is applied and the position changes. Right? So this was the second topic of this lecture. Now we will start with a new topic, which is law of conservation of energy. Right? It's a very interesting topic, and I have told you about that it also in the previous lecture also. What do you mean by law of conservation of energy? It means that energy is neither created nor destroyed, but it is just changed from one form of energy to the another form. What is the topic? Law of conservation of energy. Right? And after this we will be talking about law of conservation of mechanical energy. First of all, what is law of conservation of energy? I just told you that energy can neither be created nor be destroyed, but it can be changed from one form of energy to the another form. Let's take an example. There is a bike, right? How does a bike start, or how does a bike move? It moves because of the fuel which we pour in, right? So what does that we use a petrol or a diesel in it. So what does petrol or diesel include? They include some chemicals, right? First is chemicals. They have the chemical energy. Then, when we try to start the bike, then what happens? This chemical energy, these fuels, they burn, right? they turn into heat energy. And on the combustion, this heat energy, the bike starts and it starts moving, which is it turns into mechanical energy, right? We can similarly take a different example also. Let's say we all have seen a batteries in our life, right? So how does a battery work? A battery has some chemicals in it, right? You have seen the dry cell also, or the liquid cell also. So we generally use dry cell in our homes, or in our torches, or in our play cars, which are small cars, right? So what is it include? It includes, let's say initially the torch is off, right? So it has a chemical energy, I'm writing it as chemical energy of 100 joules, and it is off, so electrical energy EE is 0 joule. What is the total energy? It is chemical energy plus electrical energy is equal to 100 joule, right? Now let's say I turn on the torch. Now it will consume some chemical energy. So let's say the chemical energy comes down to 90 joule, and so the electrical energy consumed will be equal to 10 joule. So what will be the total energy? It will be chemical energy plus electrical energy, 90 plus 10 equal to 100 joule. So what does this mean? That energy is just changing its form from one form to the another form. It is not being dissipated, right? So it is not being wasted. That's why we say that law of conservation of energy says that energy can neither be created nor be destroyed. It can be just changed from one form of energy to the another form of energy, right? Now we come to the another important topic, which is law of conservation of mechanical energy. And there might be numericals related to this also. So listen carefully. Law of conservation of mechanical energy. Right? This is the topic. Yes. Now, what does this law of conservation of mechanical energy say? It says that for an isolated system, what do you mean by isolated system? We can say that the entire universe, our galaxy Milky Way, it is an isolated system. That means that all the asteroids, all the planets, each and everything present in it, it will just form, change its energy from one form to another form. But it will still be there. Until unless we say that let's say a UFO, there is some intrusion in our galaxy from some other galaxy, so the energy will change, right? So it says that for an isolated system, energy will be equal to, total energy will be equal to kinetic energy plus potential energy, which will be equal to half mv square plus mgh, and it will always remain constant. This will always be constant. That means it won't change, right? We will see a numerical also related to this. But first of all, let's see the explanation. Let's take an isolated system. Let's say, again, this is Earth, right? Now, this is point Q. This is point P. This is the distance H, and the mass is M. Right? Now, we will take two different positions at point Q and at point P. Right? Now, at point P, whatever the energy will be at point P, that will be equal to the at point Q. Right? Now, what is the energy at point P? It is mgh, right? Kinetic energy plus potential energy. Kinetic energy plus potential energy, and again here will also be kinetic energy plus potential energy, right? Now let's say the point it was at point P, so U was zero, so kinetic energy is zero, so zero plus mgh is equal to kinetic energy plus potential energy, right? Now see, let's say the object is dropped from point P, it comes to point Q. When it comes to point Q, then h is zero, right? Let's say it attains some velocity v, right? So half mv square plus mg into 0, h is 0, so it will be half mv square, but on the left hand side we have mgh. How do we prove that they both are equal? Let's take this half mv square. Kinetic energy is half mv square, right? Now this is when the object is dropped, then it is an accelerated motion. So we can easily use, we can easily use the equations of motion. So let's say we use third equation, which is v square minus u square is equal to 2as. But in this case, a is g, right? And this s is h, right? Displacement is h, right? So, and what is initial velocity? It is 0. So we can say that v square is equal to 2gh, right? Let's take this as 1. This is 2 and this is 1. Now simply if we put 2 in 1, we get half into m into, in place of v square we put 2gh, it gets cancelled out, we get mgh. So we can easily say that mgh is equal to mgh. This is what law of conservation of mechanical energy says, right? So very easy. What does it say? It says that for an isolated system, kinetic energy plus potential energy is always constant. So if we take this as an isolated system, let's say this is the earth, there is an object of mass m at point P, and it is released from that point and it comes to point Q on the surface of earth, and while coming it attains a velocity v. Initially the velocity was 0, so we take at point P and at point Q, what is the energy? Kinetic energy plus potential energy. Kinetic energy plus potential energy. Here kinetic energy will be 0 at point P, right? Because initial velocity is 0, so it will be equal to it will only have a potential energy of mgh. But at point Q, potential energy will be 0 because value of h is 0. So if it will be only equal to the kinetic energy, so it will be equal to half mv square. But using the equations of motion, we have found that half mv square is equal to mgh. So by that we prove that this is law of conservation of mechanical energy, right? So this was law of conservation of mechanical energy. Now let's see if there are some numericals related to it. Let's say let's do one thing. We will see the numericals related to this tomorrow when we discuss our other topic, which is power. So in this video only up till here, we will discuss the numericals and our last topic of this chapter, which is power. So thank you very much.